गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज लेक्चर नंबर 1 फॉर क्लास 11th, सब्जेक्ट इंग्लिश, फॉर चैप्टर नंबर 4, लैंडस्केप ऑफ द सोल, विच इज रिटन बाय नेथली ट्रॉवरॉय. चिल्ड्रन, दिस चैप्टर नंबर 4, लैंडस्केप ऑफ द सोल, इज टेकन फ्रॉम योर मेन कोर्स बुक हॉर्नबिल. In this lecture number 1 of this chapter, I will give you introduction and then we will read it as it is written in text, line to line. I'll let you know the difficult words with their meanings and then I'll explain those lines from your book. So, let's begin with the chapter. Children, this chapter, as I told you, is written by Nathalie Trovroy. In this chapter, the author tells us how different the Chinese art form is from the European art form. The writer uses two stories to make a contrast between the Chinese art and the European art. He tells us that European art is about reproducing an actual view, whereas a Chinese art is about not creating a real landscape. European art is an artist's way to let its viewers show exactly what he wants them to see in the landscape, whereas Chinese art is the artist's spiritual and inner voice, where you can travel from any point and it lets the viewers create a path for their imagination. So, the introduction of this lesson is that the writer Nathalie Trovroy describes how different the Chinese art form is from the European art form. So children, if you see in your book, the chapter begins with this line. A wonderful old tale is told about the painter Wu Daozi, who lived in the 8th century. His last painting was a landscape commissioned by the Tang Emperor Xuanzong to decorate a palace wall. The master had hidden his work behind a screen, so only the emperor would see it. For a long while, the emperor admired the wonderful scene, discovering forests, high mountains, waterfalls, clouds floating in an immense sky, men on hilly paths, birds in flight. "Look, sir," said the painter, "in this cave, at the foot of the mountain, dwells a spirit." Dwells means lives a spirit. The painter clapped his hands and the entrance to the cave opened. The inside is splendid. Splendid means superb, very impressive, beyond anything words can convey. "Please let me show your majesty the way." The painter entered the cave, but the entrance closed behind him, and before the astonished emperor could move or utter a word — utter means speak a word — the painting had vanished from the wall. Now, not a trace of Wu Daozi's brush was left, and the artist was never seen again in this world. So children, in these lines, the author is explaining the lines by saying that a painter named Wu Daozi, who lived in the 8th century, was assigned to decorate a palace wall by the Tang Emperor Xuanzong. It was his last painting. The painter hid his work behind the screen to the only emperor would see it, so that the only emperor would see it. The emperor, upon looking at the painting, admired many things into that painting, like discovering forests, high mountains, waterfalls, floating clouds, men on hilly paths and birds in flight, etc. The painter then made him look at a cave in the painting, which was at the foot of the mountain, and compared it with the living spirit. As the painter clapped his hands, the entrance of the cave opened and he let the emperor know how beautiful the inside of the cave was, and he asked him to show all this to him. The painter entered the cave and the entrance closed behind him. The emperor couldn't enter the cave as the emperor was greatly surprised. The painting vanished from the wall. After that, the painter Wu Daozi was never seen again. Now we will move to the next para given in your book that says, such stories played an important part in China's classical education. The books of Confucius and Zhuangzi are full of them. They help the master to guide his disciple in the right direction. Disciple means a follower or a pupil of a leader. Beyond the anecdote. Anecdote means a short interesting story of a real person. So beyond the anecdote, they are deeply revealing of the spirit in which art was considered. Contrast this story or another famous one about a painter who wouldn't draw the eye of a dragon he had painted for fear it would fly out of the painting, with an old story from my native Flanders. Flanders means a medieval country in Western Europe, right? Medieval native Flanders that I find most representative of Western painting. In these lines, the author writes, these stories played an important role in classical education in China. Similarly, like the books of Confucius and Zhuangzi are full of such stories as they help the masters to help and guide his followers in the right direction. These stories were considered to be deeply revealing of the spirit, just like the art. There was another famous story, in contrast to the previous one, where the painter wouldn't paint the eye of a dragon because he had a fear that the dragon would fly out from the painting. So it was one of the stories from many others which came from a medieval country in Western Europe. Now we'll read the lines from the book again. In 15th century, Antwerp, a master blacksmith called Quentin Mistis fell in love with a painter's daughter. The father wouldn't accept a son-in-law in such a profession, so Quentin sneaked into the painter's studio and painted a fly on his latest panel with such delicate realism that the master tried to swat it away before he realized what had happened. Quentin was immediately admitted as an apprentice into his studio. He married his beloved and went on to become one of the most famous painters of his age. These two stories illustrate what each form of art is trying to achieve, a perfect illusionistic likeness in Europe, the essence of inner life and spirit in Asia. Children, if you notice in these words, in this paragraph, there are words like Antwerp, that is a city of northern Belgium. Delicate realism. Delicate realism means the quality of art that makes it seems real. Swat. Swat means hit or crush something. Apprentice means trainee or a learner. Then it is illusionistic likeness. That is an illusion created which resembles something. So in these lines, the writer says, during the 15th century in Antwerp, a master blacksmith named Quentin Mistis fell in love with the painter's daughter. Since the father was not accepting their relationship because of his profession, as he was a blacksmith. So the blacksmith sneaked into the painter's studio and painted a fly on his latest panel. The painting was so real that the master tried to hit the fly away before he realized that it was just a painting. The blacksmith was accepted into the studio as a trainee. He married the painter's daughter and later became one of the famous painters of his age. The two stories told above are trying to illustrate the form of art in two different regions. In Europe, the art is perfect and like an illusion which resembles something. And in Asia, the art gives an essence of inner life and spirit. In next lines, the writer writes, in the Chinese story, the emperor commissions a painting and appreciates its outer appearance. But the artist reveals to him the true meaning of his work. The emperor may rule over the territory he has conquered, but only the artist knows the way within. Let me show the way. The Tao, a word that means both the path or the method, and the mysterious works of the universe. The painting is gone, but the artist has reached his goal beyond any material appearance. These lines mean, as in the Chinese story, the artist reveals the true meaning of his work to the emperor who rules over his territory but didn't know the way within. The emperor only saw the outer appearance of the wall painting. The work was mysterious and Tao, which means something which has both paths, is what the artist did. As the painting was gone after the artist reached the caves, the motive was fulfilled that some work is beyond material appearance. So, there is some art of beauty that is beyond material appearance. Now we will proceed further from the book. A classical Chinese landscape is not meant to reproduce an actual view, as would a Western figurative painting. Figurative painting means metaphoric representation of an art, right? Then whereas the European painter wants you to borrow his eyes and look at a particular landscape exactly as he saw it from a specific angle, the Chinese painter does not choose a single viewpoint. His landscape is not a real one, and you can enter it from any point, then travel in it. The artist creates a path for your eyes to travel up and down and then back again in a leisurely movement. Leisurely means unhurried or relaxed. This is even more true in the case of a horizontal scroll. Horizontal scroll in which the action of slowly opening one section of the painting, then rolling it up to move on to the other, adds a dimension of time which is unknown in any other form of painting. It also requires the active participation of the viewers who decide at what place he will travel through the painting. A participation which is physical as well as mental. The Chinese painter does not want you to borrow his eyes. He wants you to enter his mind. The landscape is an inner one, a spiritual and conceptual space. Conceptual space means relation with an abstract representation. I repeat, conceptual space means relation with an abstract representation. So children, in these lines, the writer says, the Chinese landscape painting is not made with a real viewpoint, but it's a representation of the artist's thoughts. The Western painting in Europe is a figurative art form. The European painter wants a landscape to show you a specific scene of the landscape, whereas the Chinese painter does not choose a real viewpoint. You can enter the painting from any point and can travel anywhere where your thoughts and imagination take you. The Chinese artist wants you to travel by creating your own path and then come out of it in a relaxed movement. In China, this mode of seeing a painting is more enjoyable. A horizontal scroll is a form where one section of the painting is opened one by one by rolling it up to move on to the other side. It creates a dimension which is not practiced in any other format artwork. It requires both mental and physical participation of the viewers. The Chinese painter wants you to enter his mind and see the painting from his thoughts. The landscape created by Chinese artist is spiritual, inner, and of conceptual or abstract space. Then, children, in the last paragraph, the author writes, "This concept is expressed as shanshui, literally mountain water, which used together represent the word landscape. More than two elements of an image, these represent two complementary poles reflecting the Taoist's view of the universe. The mountain here is yang, reaching vertically towards heaven, stable, warm, and dry in the sun, while the water is yin, horizontal and resting on the earth, fluid, moist, and cool. The interaction of yin, the receptive, feminine aspect of universal energy, and its counterpart, yang, active and masculine, is of course a fundamental notion of Taoism. Taoism is a Chinese philosophy based on the writings of Lao Tzu." Then he writes, "What is often overlooked is an essential third element, the middle void, where their interaction takes place. This can be compared with the yogic practice of pranayama. Breathe in, retain, breathe out. The suspension of breath is the void. Void means empty, vacant, where meditation occurs. The middle void is essential. Nothing can happen without it. Hence, the importance of the white, unpainted space in Chinese landscape. This is also where man finds a fundamental role. In that space between heaven and earth, he becomes the conduit of communication between both poles of the universe. Conduit means channel, tube. Then he says, his presence is essential, even if it's only suggested. Far from being lost or oppressed by the lofty peaks, he is, in Francois Chang's wonderful expression, the eye of the landscape." Now, in these lines, the writer says, the Chinese concept of art is also expressed as shanshui, which also means mountain water. It is used together to represent the word landscape. The two complementary poles of an image reflect the Taoist view. The mountain in the landscape is yang, which means to reach vertically towards heaven, that is stable, warm, and dry in the sun, whereas the water is the yin, which is receptive and feminine aspect of universal energy. The yang is active and masculine and the opposite of yin. There is a third essential element, which is a middle void, which is a place where they interact. This middle void can be compared to pranayama, which means to breathe in, retain, and breathe out. Hence, or here, the suspension of the breath is the void in this meditation process. It's an essential part as nothing can happen without it. Hence, the white unpainted space in Chinese landscape is equally important. Here, the middle void is the where a man finds an important role. Man is the channel of communication in the space between heaven and earth, which are two poles of the universe. man's presence is essential. It's not being lost or suppressed due to high peaks, but he is the eye of the landscape. So children, here your chapter ends. Before I proceed to the homework, I must tell you the complete summary in easy words for your better understanding. So let's start. In this chapter, the writer contrasts two forms of art, basically Chinese art and European art, by using two different stories. In China, during the 8th century, the Tang Emperor Xuanzong commissioned a painter, that was Wu Daozi. He asked him to decorate a wall in his palace. Upon seeing the wall painting, the emperor started noticing the outer appearance of the painting, but the painter drew his attention to a cave at the foot of the mountain. The painter told the emperor that he would take him inside. The painter entered the cave and the entrance closed behind him. As soon as the painter clapped his hand, the painting on the wall was gone, and so was the painter. And in another story, a painter wouldn't draw an eye of a dragon, as he had a fear that the dragon would fly out of the painting. In another story, to represent a European art form, a master blacksmith falls in love with a painter's daughter. The father did not approve of him because of his profession. The blacksmith sneaked into his painting studio and painted a fly on the painter's latest panel. The fly seemed so real that the painter tried to hit it first, but before realizing it was in the painting, the painter accepted him as a trainee then in his studio. The blacksmith married the painter's daughter and later became one of the famous painters of his time. These stories revealed as to how art form is believed to be followed in two different regions in the world. In Europe, an artist wants the viewers to see a real viewpoint by borrowing his eyes. The art must be perfect and must be illusion-likeness. Whereas in China, the artist does not paint a real one but uses his inner and spiritual voice to create an abstract piece. The viewer can enter the painting from any point and can travel according to his own imagination. And the artist wants the viewers to enter his mind and to create a path of its own. This concept is called Shanshui, which means mountain water, that is its literal meaning. And when they are used together, they make a word, that is the landscape. So children, this is the complete summary of this chapter, Landscape of the Soul. So children, as the complete chapter with its introduction has been explained, now we will proceed to homework. You are supposed to read this chapter, Landscape of the Soul, which is lesson number 4 in your main course book, Hornbill, thoroughly from your book, read it, and then write its summary in your Fair English notebook. Writing of summary will help you to understand the chapter whenever necessary. So children, read it thoroughly and write its summary in your Fair English notebook. Okay, all the best. Have a nice day.